picking a wizard up and a Bloodwiser, babe. That's what I expected.
How much did you give up in inducements?
190.
Yeah. Only because you had the journeyman.
10,000.
All right, so it's starting now. It should be loading soon, Rez. So just look out.
Match time.
Yeah, I got it refreshing.
Like it's already probably up on Twitch.
There it is.
Oh, nice. So it pulled you out relatively early. I must then prove that.
Yeah, that Cabal Vision's real sketchy on when it wants to start the stream.
Yeah. Who's home on this one? I forgot. You know, Stu?
I have no clue.
As soon as you let me know you're up, Rez, then I'm gonna go on.
There's the Bloodwiser.
Alright, man, sounds good. Yeah, I'm still loading up.
I hope you're ready. Action! We should get some today with one team having an edge over their opponents.
Alright. Oh, wait a minute.
Alright, you can see us?
This is Steve. No, this is Stevie and Hez. God damn it. There was only one game up. My bad, guys. Okay. Let's try that again. A couple technical difficulties there.
Yeah, ours is actually like on the field now, so we should be showing up.
Oh, you know what the problem is? I'm not searching by
MML?
By the right league. Yeah, I'm searching just regular MML.
Oh, right. Well, I think that should come up too.
What do you think
the toss just happened?
At least these elves don't try to hide behind armor. They know how it'll finish in the slaughterhouse.
There we go. Yeah, I tried searching TMNL, I tried searching MML, finally came up under Serious Jest.
Yeah, sometimes it delays, yeah.
Okay, now I'm loading the right game.
Okay. So in the meantime, right now, we're just, Stu is setting up his defense.
Is Stu kicking first?
Mm-hmm. He's kicking.
All right, we're live.
Good stuff. All right, I'm going on mute.
Beautiful.
See you. Good luck.
Right,
have
man.
Fun.
Good
Stu.
Luck, guys.
Thanks, Rez.
No problem, man. All right, so we've got a Wood Elf and a Lizard Man matchup going on here. I believe there was about a 190 TV difference. Stu has a Wizard, as well as I believe he has a Bloodwiser Babe. There are no playoff implications for the matchup here, but I'm sure that Jest especially is looking to get out of this without any more injuries. Got the White Owls lining up the kick here first.
Hey, I'll chime in. You know, injuries would be great, but, you know, we're looking to win. We're playing this game like it counts.
Okay.
I don't want to, because if we lose this game, TMNL is 500 on the season. So we want to come out winning.
And I want to send a message for next season.
Nice.
Well, you were a late call-up, right? Weren't you, Stu? You got called up about halfway through the season.
Two game down.
Okay, yeah. So, I mean, I remember watching, I believe it was your second match, with the War Dancer with the one-man touchdown at the end.
Yeah, that was a good game.
But, I'm looking at your team. I mean, you've definitely got some good level ups going here. It looks like you're going to be strong going into next year.
I'm fine, at least.
Yeah, that's awesome. Man, is that a Saurus I see with Kick?
On your Wizwool box, other than old
wow.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it looks like Jess has a couple of unique skills here on, I don't think I've actually caught a TMNL game yet. I watched the one last week, but just kinda was only half paying attention to it.
Then there's Dr. Flu.
Yes, I know, it's very insulting, Jess.
With Nurgle's rock travels through history, infecting everybody.
It's really rather good.
So what's your record since you've been called up,
Stu? Are better developed than my team.
I have 2 victories, I have 2 loss, and 1, no.
Oh, 1 tie?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, okay. That's a good record. Oh, is that who you tied previously?
Yep.
Oh, okay, so we've got a little bit of a grudge match going here. And the White Owls will get to set up a new defense. And see how he handles this. A lot of dodge on the team. Not much tackle for TMNL. I think I only see 1 player with tackle.
Absolutely not, Jump. I stood on the line of scrimmage and my victims, rival players, came to me.
I do have 4 Saurus with block. On the way Stu set up, that leaves the Crocs with no tackle zones on it.
There's nothing someone smaller than you, Jim.
Try to protect those low AV woodies from him. You gotta imagine it'll be the star player Spermadactyl going for the pickup once Jess is ready to attempt that. We've all spent some time reading about Spermadactyl and his exploits. We've got a push here. No Wood Elves down so far with the first 2 blocks. Really, you've got to figure the last one in the tackle zone is the one Stu's hoping doesn't get hurt.
They're getting up close and personal, Bob.
You need to be close.
Skinks are going to put on an offensive.
So they can smell your breath and see the dead insects in your teeth.
Another push.
Nuffle must be holding him up.
Let's see, Hannibal.
Curious lack of follow up with Sauron.
No Wood Elves down yet.
To stay up under such a
finally, the Velociraptor will knock down. He's got a stun. So you gotta figure all in all, Stu's pretty happy with that result. TMNL with only 5 players yet to move. See how Jess wants to play this. Brings the guard over by the cross. Maybe looking to cage up behind him. And Spermadactyl muffs the pickup. Reroll successful. Thinking about it a little bit here. Oh, and he's just gonna hang back. Doesn't want to risk any of his war dancers hopping up over the line of scrimmage. Alright, and that will end TMNL's first turn. Be interesting to see if Stu wants to try to get back to the ball or if he's just going to try to lure the Lizardman out. Spermadactyl, of course, is the leader in the Wicked Forest Conference as far as scoring leaders. Trying to reference Jess' article here so I can at least give a little bit of information.
Psst, look at rushing leaders.
Rushing leaders. Jess wants me to mention the rushing leaders. Go ahead and bring that up. You see, Spermadactyl is actually in the Western Conference. He is number one with 320 yards. And I can't help, I did happen to notice this when I was browsing through the article before. The Wicked Force does not seem to put up a lot of offense. TMNL is very strong in several of these categories. Number two in the Wicked Force Conference is Warner Hapona with 138. So kind of surprising to see that no one from the other teams has more than 138 for rushing yards. But Spermadactyl is just obviously the star offense. You know, you got another Wood Elf on the ground, but nothing serious yet.
He'll get an assist now.
That lizard line of scrimmage looked right for an over-the-top leap.
Belnus is going to take a block here. Smash Ceratops.
Thesaurus.
Manages to stun him, but again, no Wood Elves off the pitch yet. You gotta figure that's just primary objective on this opening drive, try to thin these Wood Elves down. Spermadactyl's gonna go ahead and just keep hanging back there. This is, you know, I'm cool just hanging out with the ball for now. Try to let the rest of the team get a few blocks on. He's going to make sure he's out of range. You can see Belnus is going to take a block here. Smash Ceratops.
Thesaurus.
Manages to stun him, but again, no Wood Elves off the pitch yet. You gotta figure that's just primary objective on this opening drive. Try to thin these Wood Elves down. Spermadactyl's gonna go ahead and just keep hanging back there. This is, you know, I'm cool just hanging out with the ball for now. Try to let the rest of the team get a few blocks on. And he's gonna make sure he's out of range. Can see that Sela has plus movement, making, I mean, he can cover pretty much the entire field side to side. That would make it, yeah, he's just out of his range. Both coaches playing pretty conservative so far, feeling each other out a little bit, I think, kind of trying to goad each other into a bad positioning. White Owl's really trying to keep that two-line defense together.
Hey, by the way, Rez, if you simultaneously, I don't know if you have the ability to do this, but you simultaneously pull up Twitch, my Twitch, on your computer, you can see some people, like, in the chat room with comments.
Oh, okay.
So, it might make it more interactive for you.
Sweet. Yeah, I'll go ahead.
You're doing a great job, though.
Do that.
Get in their face!
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, let me go ahead and bring that up, guys.
The attacker has an assist.
And my dog tries to zoom in so I can't see.
I've got another push here. Follow them off the pitch.
Don't believe the White Owls have knocked down any lizards yet. They've been very comfortable just trying to force the positioning, control the field.
And then we don't have to hear that weird robot voice to communicate.
He's trying to get that war dancer back towards Spermadactyl. He's gonna let that go. A failed dodge. He's just gonna let that go, try to save his reroll. Oh, wow, that's disturbing hearing myself. Okay. Yeah, I've got the Twitch up now. So you've got to wonder how aggressive TMNL will be. You see, Velociraptor has catch. Maybe try to make a dash for some positioning, but White Owls have got the manpower to just catch up to anything he tries to do down the field right now. Might see a more traditional cage here.
I might have re-rolled that dodge and used the whiz at the end of the turn.
He's gonna blitz that nine moving Robot to boys. Answer. He's going down.
Knee-saurus! Knee hit!
Yep, I reckon that's what he'd say if he could talk.
Okay, should I try to put a little more personality in my voice there, Sus? Sasser's saying he probably would have tried to re-roll that, use the wizard at the end of the turn. I mean, he does have three re-rolls, but it seems like Stu's plan is to play this very conservatively, opening up, and see how he can control the positioning.
Yes. More dead warden, sir.
Seston cheering for dead ward answers. Still no White Owls taking off the pitch yet. We're gonna get a little bit of skink movement now. Try to stretch out that White Owl defense, probably. It looks like he's really trying to position himself and get that cage
not
going.
Not your robot voice. Do you not hear the text-to-speech uh-huh. It's using for our comments?
No, I had it muted there, Sasser. I don't know if I can... I'm not very experienced with Twitch or anything like that.
We're building a cage around the ball here. It's a solid tactic.
I don't know if I can unmute it in here. Yeah. Not quite sure how to get. I know what robot voice you're talking about
though,
now. That
you should
it.
Throw some impressions and accents into your repertoire.
It sucks, man.
Maybe
I don't
robot
have a
sexy
cool,
talk.
Yeah, you know, cool accent like some of these guys. I mean, we got guys from all over the world playing here. You hear some of these guys talking, and it's like, oh, well, my voice isn't very exciting, you know. It looks like TMNL is just trying to get the skinks spread out a little bit. Try to get the White Owls to commit. And they're really standing firm in the middle of the field right now, making it hard. Yeah, Seston wants some sexy Siri talk. Yeah, can I make it do the robot voice and not hear myself? Because Yeah, that part's not cool.
You can a cappella some Nine Inch Nails for us.
I can put some Nine Inch Nails on for you, but no, I don't think you're gonna get me breaking out into song yet. Maybe if you see a war dancer kill a skink, maybe we'll get something going. But yes, I'm blatantly cheering for the Wood Elves. That's,
you are
that's
doing
the,
great.
Race that
I'm
prefer.
Just trying to make Lady Robot
safe. It's always nice to see some skinks trying to pull some crazy stuff like we saw earlier today in the Green Tide Titans Leaping Lizards game. I believe that was Ricky who ran through about 50, but I think it was about three tackle zones and just took off for the touchdown. Yes, Sess, if I could figure it out, man, I'd get it going, but... I don't know how to do that. Now I'm clicking on stuff. And yeah, I'm just gonna end up screwing it up. White Owl spreading out a little bit, but they're not trying to come into contact with those Sauri.
I want to set her up for my Twitch.
Hey! Okay, yeah, and again, staying pretty conservative. Let's see how Jess wants to try to play this. If he wants to try to hang on to the ball for a little while.
Looking like a good wooden defense.
Just score.
Balance of pressure on the ball, but enough players in the backfield to prevent stalling if he breaks through.
Yeah, I agree, Sasser. I think Jess is doing a really nice job not taking the bait. A lot of guys get caught up trying to beat up on the low AV team and kind of lose their positioning. I think Jess is doing a nice job in not overcommitting, trying to force Stu into making the positioning mistake, which somebody has to eventually. Somebody's going to get forced into a bad spot. That skink with catch is what really has me concerned. I mean, that can make that handoff a lot easier. Double skulls. Oh, and I see we've got Thundin the catcher. I just now noticed this. We've got Velociraptor knocking down Thundin here. Still no injuries. Very, very surprising that no woodies have been taken off the pitch yet. Got that big 5 strength Sorai just kind of strutting around the middle of the field.
I'm really not sure about passing on all these Sorai follow-ups, though. Allowing Stu to conserve his rerolls.
He's just kind of daring anybody to come up and mess with him. Just taking his time, very deliberate. Yeah, I'm surprised to see both coaches play such a conservative style. I mean, you don't usually see that. It's interesting. But usually you see one guy try to get aggressive after a couple of turns. Both guys are really sticking with their game plan so far. This is what you have to love about the MML guys. I mean, these are experienced coaches. They know what they're doing. They know their teams very well. And they're not going to be goaded into breaking out of their game plan.
Being at such an important match?
This is why it's always interesting to watch these games.
Ask me again when there's more blood on the field. Yeah.
Try to keep the tackle zones on those skinks. At least affect the any kind of handoff or pass attempt rolls. I mean, you can see at the beginning of each turn, each coach is taking their time. They're really making sure to take stock of where their guys are going to end up after everything's moved. Although it does provide me, in my first attempt announcing a couple of breaks, a couple of dead air moments here, I'm gonna just kind of let go. This is why I need shots or somebody here to help me co-announce.
You're doing good, man. Chiming in off of mute while I don't have to think too much, but
awesome.
Stu is a tactician, man. I've played with Stu on the farm and in the league before. He is a definite tactician, and if anybody...
I love seeing a good Wood Elf coach. Well, any coach, but I mean, I play the Wood Elf, so I like seeing a low AV team
contractually, I'm not
play
allowed
smart.
To say, jump.
But you're not taking the bait, man.
No, I know better.
Is this going to be enough to come out on top?
He's going to try to come up on the Saurus. Still no injuries. I mean, we're halfway through the first half. No injuries. A couple of stuns here and there, but nothing significant. His War Dancers just trying to make sure they're not... not ending up in any Sorai tackle zones at the end of the turn. And despite the fact that this has no playoff implications, we're still getting a good few viewers in here. I mean, it's always, like I was saying, you know, people like to watch coaches who know what they're doing. Again, White House staying conservative, just trying to keep the tackle zones, at least force TMNL into making the rolls to get through. That Dilgul has really been tempting fate, and he finally goes out. He really hung in there for a while, getting knocked around, but he finally had to give in.
Yes, the unmistakable sign of a player's eyes rolling up into his head.
Now the Saurus are looking to just increase that pain a little bit. But no, another push. You can see the development of the teams. They've got block on their teams. Each team has several skills on their players that are helping to keep this from breaking open one way or the other. With that KO, you can see Jest is going to try to advance his positioning a little bit. We're halfway through first half. Probably thinking that's probably a good opportunity to take a couple squares. And more skink blocking. Just try to loosen that up a little bit. Making sure there's nobody coming around, trying to come through the back of that cage. Looks like he's probably gonna hold there again this turn. And you've got to wonder at what point the White Owls. Wow. And there you go. You see the stunny in action. We saw it earlier today, and it continues on later into the evening. Wow. You're just trying to get me, man, aren't you?
Ornithopona. Yeah.
I said it fine earlier, now I can't say it.
Ornithopona. It's a real old school, like, dinosaur name.
Really? I know the ornithopter. I thought that was just like a play on that. Okay.
No, it's a play on ornithopoda, I think. Or I think I just switched the spelling.
See, now I got you screwed up too.
Yeah, it was so long ago I came up with these names, and now we've moved to instead of dinosaurs, we're doing the single letter or the single name artists.
Yeah, I saw you've got Prince, and I read about Homer joining the squad as well. Always been a fan of the Iliad and the Odyssey. Yeah, it's always nice to see. Man, the creativity of guys never ceases to amaze me. I was really lazy with naming my teams. I would name, like, the star players, and that was it. And I'm trying to get away from that a little bit and at least come up with a theme for the teams now. There we see a... Can't tell. Okay, no, that's just down. You've got to think the White Owls are going to start trying to pick off these skinks here soon. I believe Jest has a couple of injuries coming in. I'll pull that up here on the site. That's what's nice about having guys like Shots and Jest taking care of the apothecary reports, league leaders, playoff scenarios. They're actually all three right here together on the site. Stu's still content. He likes his positioning.
Yeah, skink bashing is a good counter to this conservative offense.
Now Jess has got to be looking at the turns left and thinking it's time to figure out at least what his approach is going to be. Still more pushes.
That player is so close.
He's going to follow up and probably try to surf him next turn. Let's see, I'm seeing Torpedo Raptor and Kilmono Dragon for TMNL are both out. Don't believe I see any. The White Owls are also missing a lineman, Bellarifa. White Owls apparently had Willow on their team last week, who was murdered in the line of duty. And you can see the Crocs rolling Bonehead.
And that stupid Willow even got my MVP.
Isn't that always the case? Isn't that always the case? Oh, man. Yeah, I've seen reports, and Shots references it in his article. Man, these star players, they take that money and they do not care at all about what happens with your match. Sometimes they may come out and actually feel like competing just because they feel like it. but do not expect them to sacrifice anything. If they can get out there and, you know, fake an injury, flop a little bit, get off the pitch, they're gonna do it. So just keep that in mind with a lot of these star players. And I see Sasser, yeah, that's really the only thing I can think of. Now I'm not very experienced, but I would think to start trying to bash those skinks the way that this game's going. That's probably going to be his best chance. Although we've only got one KO so far in the match. I mean, doesn't seem like Knuffle's very bloodthirsty yet. Maybe he's got to get warmed up. Now, I saw in the Bretonian match earlier, there was at least one death. Dead Blitzer, so maybe he slaked his thirst a little bit there, but yeah, I'm gonna be very surprised
this looks like a whiz turn.
If this pattern of nobody getting hurt holds up.
Nice! Very nice.
Can you see the skinks doing their thing again? Ornithopona. Nail it that time. Shaking himself free, at least making sure that he's making the White Owls chase him, trying to stretch that defense out. Sasser saying he thinks this is a wizard turn, and I can't disagree with him. I mean, you've got five players there, but that's always a difficult decision to make. Stu says no, he's going to hold on a little bit longer. White Owls appeared very confident in their defense. They've only got one guy off the pitch so far. In my personal opinion, anytime that the Wood Elves aren't down at least two players, they have the advantage.
Well, they had to retreat a little. It was getting dangerous.
He's going to get a little more aggressive here. We might see a cage leap. You can see his war dancer, Milmnor, has stripped ball. Be interesting to see if he goes for it here, or if he's just trying to set up his positioning and stall that cage out a little bit. Both coaches still taking their time, very deliberate with their turns.
I like this.
He doesn't even have to leave.
Dung is about to hit. Oh.
And Spermadackle's going down. Still no injuries. And look at that. Thunden has the ball. And Jess has just got to be spitting mad about that one.
I'm just like, uh-oh.
Now you see it.
Nice.
Yeah, that, he's got that 9 movement war dancer up in position. He can't score this turn, but he can probably keep it out of your range except for a skink or two.
Thunden.
Let's see if he's happy with keeping it with Thunden, or if Thunden's going to try to throw a pass here.
Very nice.
A quick pass here should do nicely.
Oh, he rolls a 1. He's got the reroll.
They can score.
And the War Dancer has it. Fatsila. Let's see. Now he's going to try to set up some screen. The Saurus can't block him, but he can get next to him. Cross and make it with 2 gold for it. Oh, he's got a failed dodge there. And another stun. Stu saying he didn't mean to dodge through the zone that way. I can relate. Sometimes you're trying to move quickly and it just doesn't plot it out the way you think it should. We've got a KO prior to that. Let's see if the crowd adds on any.
Lucky bit of volleyball to get it in the hands of the catcher that hadn't moved yet, but opportunistic blitz.
Yeah, I liked the blitz. I thought that was a great decision, and I mean, when you've got that 4 agility, anytime the ball starts scattering around, you've got a chance to come down with it. Jess can still get plenty of tackle zones on this War Dancer potentially, though. And he's probably gonna have to roll a couple of go for it, but he's still in position. And this is not what Stu wants to see. Throw damage right on the sideline.
Oh, what's happening? He's been just
strip ball jump up war dance is going to the sideline. Now we're finally starting to see some of the Wood Elves go down, but they're only KOs. And if he can score, that's going to be two KO rolls before the second half.
Have a babe.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's right. Thanks for reminding me, Stu. Yeah, he's got the Bloodwiser babe, so he's only going to have to roll, three or higher. And there's the Crocs getting up there, and he's got the prehensile tail, so that's already a 67% dodge to get away from him now. Trying to shut down the screen a little bit. We'll see how aggressive he gets with these skinks. Taking his time, making sure the positioning's in place. Figure if he can get the ball back, he can still score. I mean, very easily. He's got a skink down in scoring position. I believe he can get two of them up there to get a two-die block on that dancer, but that would mean he couldn't advance the ball then.
Fast and impossible to tell. The fans will love it.
Here comes the first skink. And again, all day long, folks, all day long, you're going to see these stunties just do their thing. And this is something I've been curious about. I haven't actually seen it in action. Maybe somebody in the chat or one of the coaches could help me. If you have AG4, does that make that an 83% dodge with stunty? Like, do you still ignore the tackle zones and have the 83% dodge for everything?
Yes.
Wow. Wow. To kill the fool, oh, we see the War Dancer go down. Stop him from scoring. No stun, though, so, I mean, he's still got a shot to try and pick that ball up. And Jess is going to pull Skink back from scoring by the end zone. I believe, he could still get in the end zone next turn without too much trouble. Now we'll see how Stu wants to play this. Try to get tackle zones on the skinks to try to impede any kind of catches.
He's not taking any chances.
No. I love it, man. I love seeing coaches who know what they're doing, know what order to do stuff in. So I tell my buddies, this is basically just fantasy football and chess kind of mixed together, you know? Obviously not like actual fantasy, but fantasy and football mixed together.
He just dodged out of that fucking prehensile tail like
right.
It was nothing, bro.
Now, it's hard to see after all those stunty dodges you complain about those.
Yeah, true.
Now, can he score?
Yeah, he can. Scooping up the ball. My God!
No. Oh, my. There it is, and there it is. Beautiful defense from the Wood Elves. A lot of patience, a lot of luck on the injury rolls and the pushes early on. But you got to take advantage when you get your opportunities. That was a great. He's going to get two of his KOs back too. Didn't see. Now the War Dancer's still on the sideline, but he'll get another chance to wake him up here at halftime.
He probably learned from. Thundin's game, he did not let my skin sit there with the ball.
Possession is the key to winning. It must drive the coach
now
crazy.
He's got nine moves. It would take some serious chain pushing to try to pull off a one-turner. It looks like he's gonna move his guys back. All I don't see. Yeah. I've been, I have a guy who's one movement short of one turning. So I'm trying to get the hang of pushing off the chain, off the line of scrimmage to see about one turning when I need to. But, I still haven't really got the hang of it. I've only tried it once. Yeah, the White Owls are just gonna hang back, kick the ball off, say we're happy to get that. We're up 1-0. We kicked it to the Lizards to start. And it's been a very dodgy kinda.
Ingana start naming so players far. After you guys. Looks fun.
Seston says he's gonna start naming players after the coaches as well, after that score by Thundin. Was that Thundin that scored?
I'm only naming the one that kills my guy.
Okay, I heard that proposal. I don't remember where that came up. I think it was Shots that proposed it.
You better get ready for a serious jest then there, Stu.
Oh, we got a little bit of trash talking going on now here. Jess is getting all fired up now after that touchdown. You can hear Stu saying that he is naming his players that are killed. He is naming the replacements after the coach that kills them. So make sure you kill some of Stu's players and you'll get a piece of MML history.
That way I remember who I have to kill after.
Stu says it's for revenge purposes. Serious Jess has his I'll remember that list. There's one person on it as far as I know. I've seen it posted in the chat a couple of times, and that would be Chase. And I've had plenty of matches with Chase. He's actually the person who introduced me to MML from another league. And yes, Chase will mess your team up in the farm if given the opportunity. So, yeah, you can see there's a little bit of vengeance in some of these coaches' hearts. But that's, we all get very attached to our players. I'm sure Jess is just hoping to get some of these woodies off the pitch. Beating up on the journeyman. Stu says, I don't care. That journeyman's hanging tough. It'd be interesting to see if Jess throws a foul or anything here trying to get one of these woodies off the pitch. I have changed some of my fouls.
Spoiler alert.
Exactly.
That was going to happen as soon as this. As soon as Randall left. Well, that guy's not the candidate.
Dilgaleel finally got rid of him. He's turning into a punching bag.
He's a pain in my ass. He is gone.
Yeah, I mean, okay. he was like the linchpin of the defense for the most part.
If I'm not mistaken, Dilgaleel is probably in the top leaders for being KO'd or hurt all the time.
Is he?
I think he is.
That's
at least
what
for
happens.
The KOs.
You get a guy that you feel could. I mean, he's got blodge. He's a lineman. You feel like he should be the guy up front. You know, he's gonna get knocked down sometimes. Sasra, I'm still waiting. I put in for. I'm in the Eastern Time Conference. I basically just looked at those. I think the one was the Noble South, and then the other was the one that was specifically Eastern Time.
Damn it, Stu. Nobody to foul.
And I'm supposed to be, as long as Preach is still available at some point this evening.
Yeah, no thanks.
Jess has no interest in fouling that journeyman.
Damn it. They must
have glue on their fingers. That was a good try, Stu. It was a good try. We're gonna see Spermadactyl try to farm a little SPP, maybe. There it is. You've got the catch. There's the SPP.
Yeah, you know me.
Wow. You know, we're all constantly dating ourselves throughout this whole thing. Oh man, so I'm curious to see what Stu does here. I have a feeling we're just gonna see a quick ended turn, but I wonder if he's considering throwing that wizard down and getting an injury.
Oh,
he wants to throw a blitz. He wants to throw a blitz.
No, he's coming for a source.
Oh, fails to go for it. There you go, he makes the second one, just barely with a two. I think Stu wants that tackle off the pitch.
Yeah, he wants him.
Right.
Okay, good.
Oh, can't get him. A lot of pushes in this match, a lot of pushes.
Yeah.
Both teams have a lot of block too, so, I mean. Alright, and that's halftime. White Owls with a defensive touchdown, up 1-0. TMNL in danger of finishing the season at .500 despite having their conference locked up 2 weeks early. See, that's my dog agreeing with me, so that's kind of crazy, man.
It's going to be hard now that they're outnumbered.
So yeah, the White Owls will get the ball here. That War Dancer wake up. No, the War Dancer's still down.
It'll be on the way back to them soon enough.
The White Owls are down two players. Still no injuries for TMNL. Still not positive how I feel about TMNL sometimes, because I grew up very heavily on the Ninja Turtles, Jess, and reading some of the articles, man, I never thought of it that way when I was a little kid, but yeah, you're a very creative person, my friend.
All right, one question.
I see Overlord, he has a question. Oh, and Sasser wants to know, Jess, if you want to comment on not following up with your Saurus a lot throughout the first half. Through a lot of blocks where you just stayed put, held your positioning. Wants to know if you have any regrets about maybe not following up, trying to get a little rougher. And Overlord, he also wants to know, just why you gave your Saurus an agility point, which is a question I've wondered myself.
I was wondering the two.
In retrospect, I agree. I regret not putting the tackle zones on. I was kind of just hoping he would let me set up where I wanted to.
Yeah, I'm not saying it was a mistake. It's just, I mean,
no, it was a mistake.
It's definitely a way he could have gone. Yeah, hindsight's 20/20.
What are they gonna replace it?
I didn't want to let him get the ability to start.
Understand.
To start ganging up on the guys that I left. You know, these guys, these wood elves can dodge right out and then create 3-on-1s, 2-on-1s.
I think Stu dictated a lot of how you approached that too. I mean. In order to spread him out, you had to start sending skinks down the field, so you needed the Saurus to keep the tackle zones with the skinks.
Right.
But, I mean, definitely, both points are very valid.
If I had one more turn, and if he had not blitzed that War Dancer when he did, the next turn was a touchdown.
Yeah,
I was very confident.
Yeah, exactly.
I already had my plan of attack.
It was Sasser that was saying he really... Tackle. Yeah, Vassassar saying he really thought that was a wizard turn, but
yeah.
The War Dancer did plenty enough there.
Yep.
But do you care to address the agility point?
I got it, and I figured why not? It's another arsenal. You know, it's another weapon in my arsenal.
So, I mean, I understand the thought of rolling it and getting and being happy
about it,
especially. I mean, agility and strength you don't see as often, but you essentially made him a troll slayer.
Say that again?
As you essentially made him a troll slayer.
Yeah,
like,
in a way, yeah.
He's a dwarf.
But you never know. I mean, I might have that situation where I need that agility, and if I get another one, he becomes nasty.
Oh, yeah, if he could potentially roll another agility, that would be amazing. I've never seen that, but... Yeah, I
close and personal.
Fully valid point. Fully valid point.
I think so is.
Smell your breath and see the dead insects.
Now you've got Prince being knocked down by Fatsila. Curious to see if he ends the turn. Oh, he's gonna get way aggressive. Yeah, wow. Wow, that I know there are a lot of coaches in this league that salivate when they get a free shot at a War Dancer like that. He's sending all his stars down there, just kind of hoping that you can only contain so many of them.
Sure hands him. Saurus ball
also,
carrier, like an old school fullback P.
I like kick. I think any team benefits from kick over Lordy. I mean, I'm not a horribly experienced coach, But I personally think any team benefits from kick, because it may not benefit you all the time, but there are times where it really can benefit you. If you've got your other team bashed down, if they leave a big opening somewhere and you can get the ball to land there, I disagree. I think kick is always a good decision. Sasser says to put sure hands on that AG2 Saurus. Saurus ball carrier. I agree, that would be a Mike Alsat type player right there. Maybe even a Refrigerator Perry type player.
Definitely been thinking about that.
We'll see. That's a legitimate way to go with him.
Gone into the opponent's
yeah, Sora, I mean, have general and strength kick. Access, basic, right?
Say that again?
Sora, I have general and strength access, right?
Oh, wait, hold on. I gotta concentrate on this.
Trying to make the dodge. Okay, he made it. He got that one. Really aggressive with his offense here. It's a stark contrast from the defense we saw in the first half. But I bet Stu's probably thinking if he can get a second score here, it's going to be really hard for those lizard men to match 2-0. And another failed dodge. Wow. Yeah, you can't plan for that. I agree, Sasser. That would be the lizard fridge. Not to mention he's already got guard on him. I mean, it would make it... It would make it interesting. Guard, block, agility. So yeah, if you could get sure hands on there, that'd be interesting. He'd never pick it up in the rain. Let's see how Just approaches this. I mean, he's got two catchers and a war dancer just asking to take hits. Looks like the catchers don't have any levels except for the catcher with wrestle. So yeah, I mean, each tackle Zenny puts on is a -1 to any attempt to get him the ball. Uh-huh. You got the Skinks trying to put on some tackle zones as well. The catcher's not such a big deal. They're both strength 2 players.
You'll get an assist now.
Let's see. Can he get? I guess that guard player's gonna have trouble getting up there. So it's pretty much those 3 players on their own right now. See, now that's where it really starts to hurt, because he really needs a handoff or a pass to a second player in order to try to get in the end zone here. Trying to use that throw to kick it straight to one of those players down the field is going to be really hard to do. You really need the 2-player chain there.
Sometimes the underdog wins the
fight. Still no injuries. Oh no, we did see the lineman go down earlier. Still very surprising. That journeyman's taking a lot of punishment.
Saurus ball carrier is horribly inefficient.
There's a fun factor involved too, Overlord. Yeah, I agree, he's not the most efficient player, but it's a luxury kind of at that point. I mean, you see he's got the 4 agility skink. That's his main ball carrier. He's thinking he's trying to have some foresight as far as getting unique circumstance. Now you can definitely question how effective it would be, but I like the thought at least. You see the thrower go down. Ouch. Smash Ceratops. Knocks the ball free. Homer can't quite get to it, but we're gonna see him try a couple go for it probably. Yep. That's 2 tackle zones on the ball for TMNL. Quite a show going on here. We've got a lot of people in the chat, a lot of people enjoying the show. It'd be really interesting to see if TMNL can get the ball here and try to even the score up. The White Owls were really aggressive. They wanted to try to get that that finishing touchdown put the Wizards down 2-0, but not quite sure it's going to happen that way.
Inefficient or totally badass, like a pizza-eating anthropomorphized turtle?
You see Thunden coming back towards the other side of the pitch.
Come on, guys. Team spirit is the key. Well,
sorry. You...
Spermadactyl was down. Jest is going to go ahead and let him take the KO. Boy, that's, and I know he's got other skinks, but boy, having that 4 agility is a big difference, especially when you're trying to get that pickup.
New Spermadactyl feels
badly. Both coaches made it very clear that they are playing to win, and Velociraptor goes down. He's stunned. Wood Elf striking back a little bit.
Accurate.
I agree, Sasser. I think it's totally badass.
That's doubles, yes, isn't it?
I would love to see the Soros Bridge. He tries to knock the ball free a little bit here, so now there's only one tackle zone. Can't get skinked down, though. And that, I believe, is Jess' newest recruit, Homer. You may recognize him from such great works as the Iliad and the Odyssey. What he and Prince have in common, I'm not totally positive, other than the fact they now play for TMNL.
All artists of a single, known by a single name.
Okay. I like it. I'm not hating on Prince either. I love some Prince, but yeah, I was just like trying to make the connection. You see those catchers coming back towards the other side of the pitch a little bit. Stu may have gotten a little ahead of himself.
He tries to secure the ball.
He's trying to get tackle zones on the ball.
There was one awesome game last season with the Soros who picked up the ball out of a tackle zone, dodged out, then scored to tie the game. What? Explain to me, bro, why would someone get accurate on a skink? Remember who?
I don't think skinks have access to
you,
like a good old-fashioned fight.
Basic.
Look on. Intimidation is the key.
Wait a minute, Sasser. You're telling me that Soros dodged out of a tackle zone?
Because makes passing to Soros easier. Not me.
Overlordy, if he's got 4 AG and accurate, he can bomb that from almost anywhere.
Madonna and Cher are next.
-1 to his pass, I believe.
Oh,
but,
I see. My bad.
That's beside the point because Homer has picked up the ball. I did love that response there of makes passing to the source easier.
And Crocs is for what? For intercepts?
So Jess is going to try to make sure he keeps these elves in his tackle
archives.
Zones.
I'm pretty sure Hero Soros
He's
got
still
a press
make that
release.
Dodge out. It's a good percentage,
it was
but
epic.
It's always smart to make your
yeah.
moves.
That's quite a mismatch,
that you don't have to make any rolls on. Again, you see the veteran nature of the coaches in this league. It's always fun to watch. Everyone makes mistakes from time to time, but
Crocs is
90% of the time, you're going to see guys take their time and make the right moves first. Now, interesting to see if he tries to hit that last Wood Elf or just go for the score. Or if he's going to try to stall. I don't think he will. Both coaches have made it very, very clear that they are trying to win the game. Neither is playing for a tie. This game does not have any playoff implications, but both coaches are going full tilt.
Who is on the commentary?
Good sportsmanship. Trying to put on a good show for everybody. This is Rez shots. Free bin. I could have used you. You can feel free to jump in if you want, man.
Reznor rules you.
If Shots wants the invite, I can do it right now while we're moving to the next half. but he has to let me know
now. To him and just send it to him. If he doesn't want to join, that's fine. But
alright, I'll do it after I set up defense.
Sounds cool, man. Sounds cool.
Nice score, Jess.
Thanks, Sasser.
And Nosedive says that skinks are for feeding to opponents, and all ball handling should be done by the Saurus and the Crocs.
This needs to be a hell of a catch.
Aggressive offense countered by aggressive defense.
Yeah, that's it's been a really, really interesting comparison between the first and second half, Sasser. Both coaches very conservative in the first half, led to a defensive touchdown. Both coaches very aggressive in the second half, leads to a defensive touchdown. Offense is really really having some tough time here in this game.
Yep. Passing access is doubles.
There may be a small break in Twitch. I'm just inviting shots to the party.
Yeah, so don't worry anybody in case your stream cuts out for a moment. It'll be right back.
I'm not even sure if they could hear us at this point. Alright, ready. Sorry guys. We're back on. We should be back on.
I hear.
Seth says he can't still hear us. And
okay.
Stream is back up.
Alright.
Bit of a lull. What are
yeah,
you
that,
up
if you feel like joining shots,
Think
feel free.
We can't
don't
hear
sweat
you.
It, man.
You can voice your darkest
secrets. I don't
secrets.
Think I butchered too badly. Seemed like we're doing okay. We can't. Sasser says we can't hear you, Jess. You can go ahead and voice your darkest secrets, buddy. I don't know if we want to hear Jess' darkest secrets. His open secrets weren't suitable for the MML site at times. We've only heard small rumors and glimpses into what Prince's involvement with TMNL is meant.
LOL.
A lot of turnovers and short kick there. It's raining now.
Preach edited me on that article. In that
Preach
article,
has a small child who takes part in the league, and you are a sick, sick man.
In that article, the original version, April O'Neil finds herself in the club bathroom with Prince after looking into his eyes.
Oh my! It's not a. Now I'm a Steelers fan. I try to avoid any of those kind of conversations. But is it a Big Ben-esque? Type encounter?
No. It's you know how they used to say that about the real Prince. They said, "Don't ever look into his eyes, whatever you do."
Right. Oh my. But we always enjoy reading your articles, Jess. Like I said, I think it's great. We've got a lot of creative guys who like what they're doing here. I mean, we all yeah. It seems
now
like most of us are pretty much grown ass men, taking
feet.
Time to have fun, yeah, take some stress off each other. It's nice.
Stuff.
The White Owls trying to make sure they secure that ball.
MML
now,
got kicked off the big screen to watch
to
the Prince squash the Lightning
with their AG4, but it definitely makes it difficult. No sure hands there. And Stu's still sitting on that wizard as well. Be interesting to see when he tries to do that. And Sasser says that we got kicked off the big screen so that he can watch the Pens game. I've actually got that streaming on my tablet. It's kind of nice. The NHL is much more friendly with their streams than other leagues.
You gotta concentrate, Rez.
This is why we need a shot, so I can deflect some of my pauses when I'm trying to watch them to him.
And then he shows up right on cue.
Exactly. There he is. How you doing,
I was
Shots?
At the bar eating pizza and hitting on random witch elves, and all of a sudden I saw there was a game. I had to rush home through traffic. Dang near killed a goblin on my way in. He was riding a pogo stick.
Well, hopefully you
But
ran
I got
over
here in
gnomes.
Time for the important shit.
Exactly. You're here
I
for the clutch,
we
man. We just, started this drive. Tied 1-1. Got a hell of a game going so far. Got a pretty decent audience.
Yeah, I saw there's like a horde of people up in there. The elves seem to be holding up pretty good. Only one of them in the injury box. The skinks are all alive still, so I mean, it may have been bashy in that, but earlier today.
I don't know what happened, man, because I expected a little bit more blood in this match. That elf basically got hurt because Stu dangled him in front of the Sorak for four turns.
Well, you know, every now and then you got to tempt the Sorak. That's just the way it is, you know.
And yes, Sasser, I am a PA guy. I'm about 40 miles south of Pittsburgh. But Steelers, Penguins. I don't get huge into baseball, but yeah.
Yeah, very good. Ball safe. The Elves got it kind of tucked away. It'll be interesting to see how aggressive they get.
I don't know if you saw this last score shots, but we had a complete change of pace from the first half. The first half was slow, conservative, and all of a sudden, both coaches got like crazy aggressive here in the second.
Which really begs the question, what happened in the locker room at halftime? did everybody get into the Peruvian marching powder or something? I mean, generally this kind of aggression is really brought on by some kind of outside substance.
With Prince around, you never know what kind of substances may be available to the teams. I mean,
it's a shorter list if you go with the substances that aren't available for the teams.
That's a very good point. So who knows what, I mean... And you may have had Jest or Prince himself spike some of the drinks.
They definitely know how to pick up a party. That's for certain.
But we had almost no injuries, very little going on in the first half. We've got a couple guys on the sidelines. Both coaches really decided they had enough of waiting around.
Oh, we got a war dancer under attack now. Luckily, they both have blocks, so this will just be a push. We've all seen how fragile these war dancers can be at times. We've had quite a few war dancer deaths in the league this year. So every time one of those comes under attack, you know it could be the last time for him.
Well, I've referenced it a couple of times throughout this game, and you would be one of the main guys I had in mind when referencing it. That a lot of our coaches salivate at the mouth at the thought of a clean shot on a war dancer. I mean,
I'm not against it. I don't in particular target them, but I do look for a guy that has a little bit higher team value when I'm picking my blitz. Like, if I got Mighty Blow and he's just kind of hanging out, if I'm throwing two dice on it, I'm going to take that all day. I don't think a lot of coaches are going to avoid that.
Oh, no, certainly not. I was a bit surprised when I saw Stu throw his War Dancer and both his catchers straight down the field on that last drive.
Well, he's not holding anything back. It's one of those things where, you know,
you can't hold anything back.
Exactly.
Yeah, I remember that.
The Lizards are definitely pressing the Elves here, though. They're keeping in contact. They're trying to push the game here. They definitely have taken a good offensive approach towards this defensive stance, because they're looking to deal out some punishment here in this next turn. We'll see if the Elves can wiggle free and get up the field. But right now, it's looking like the TMNL is really looking to keep with that aggressive nature that you had brought up a little bit ago.
It's a very interesting change in the pace, and I think it was Sasser had asked Jess for this comment on it, and he did address and say, you know, hindsight's 2020, but the Saurus really didn't follow up a lot of their blocks in the first half, more about positioning than trying to inflict any kind of damage, and you see Jest has really changed that position in the second half.
And part of that, a lot of times you end up seeing it in the first half, both coaches want to feel each other out some, kind of get a feel, and then once time starts ticking down and they start seeing the clock, a lot of times you'll see coaches will panic a bit and they'll go over aggressive sometimes. And then other times it's a tale of two stories, where you'll have one coach that'll go way aggressive and the other one will go very passive,
like the game that you guys called for me.
Yeah, it can be a bit all over the road, but I think right now what you're seeing is the elves are trying to kind of use positioning, maybe even lure the lizards in, so they can pop one of their fast runners or something like that loose.
It looks like they might want to try to burn a couple turns.
Well, we saw earlier today the leaping lizards basically two turned with a skink, and I think a lot of people they focus on the Skaven and some of the other elf teams that are known for their mobility. I think a lot of people get lulled into a false sense of hope with the Sauri touchdowns being slow, or you know, the skinks have more than enough speed to do damage when they need to, and you just see people kind of forget it sometimes. I know I've done that mistake several times.
Well, you don't look at it. One skink isn't anything intimidating, but two skinks is a one-die block on most players, especially ones that'll have the ball.
Well, and the other thing is once they get one step on you, they have that dodge. They may not have block, but they have dodge,
Stunty
and that
has
dodge
ruined
ability.
Many a match.
Yeah, and that dodge is enough for, you know, when you're throwing even two dice on it. It takes away another option to knock him down. So it's to the point where, yeah, you can get that push and that defender stumbles, which is normally gold. You look at the defender stumble, go, perfect, I take that. All of a sudden you're burning rerolls, you're rerolling into two skulls. I mean, I don't think dodge gets as much respect as it sometimes should, because it can really screw up an attack.
I'm really surprised by the lack of tackle on a lot of these teams. Now, my team doesn't have it. But, I mean, I'm an elf team. I've had to focus on a couple of other skills before I can try to get that on my blitzers.
Well, with an elf team, you can kind of counteract a lot of the dodgy nature, though, because you have enough speed to keep up with the guy. And then also, you also have the higher agility if they try to pass into coverage and different stuff like that. You can also have an increased chance of interception. Where you really see it lacking is when an orc team comes up against an elf team. Uh-oh. We've got both down. We've got a reroll. Oh, and we got a skink coming good.
Jess has not been afraid to throw blocks with the skinks all game long.
I have to admit, I've played around with Lizardmen on the farm. I don't like to admit it a lot about my Lizardmen playing days, but it's to the point where, like you said, if you get a skink or two with a little help, I've had my skinks probably kill more people than my Sauri, just because it's that open block that you have where you can just kind of pin a guy in and really. And really just, you know, two, three skinks on them, and it's that last block you throw. You can re-roll it sometimes if you got extra re-rolls, and all of a sudden the guy's already pinned down, and, yeah, the skink, you know, flicks a tongue at the guy's head, and it cracks the skull or something. And it's, all of a sudden you're just looking and going, I didn't mean to do that, but I'll take it.
Just on a side note, I love the animations for the blocks. You got to love some of these animations.
The skink animations are absolutely hilarious. They're always trying to like catch their helmet because it comes flying off. It really kind of adds something to the whole, okay, they're only 7 armor thing, because like half the time their armor's falling off of them.
I've got to laugh here, and I remember seeing some messages about this before and having some empathy about Sasser saying the number 2 War Dancer team for the Treehawks has a 2-game life expectancy.
I remember there was a revolving door for the locker room. They wouldn't even hang their names up when they showed up because of how quickly they get replaced.
That is 120,000 gold player. That is brutal.
But that being said, you know, 7 armor. You gotta almost expect it.
It hasn't affected the Treehawks any worse for their record.
Yeah, but they've been a solid team for a while. That was back in Season 2. They got a real bad rap early because they had some off games. And that was one of those teams where I early on, I think it was like Week 4 or something like that, this season was about halfway through, and they were struggling. And you just looked at the team and the build of them and went, if they get 2-3 weeks where they stay healthy, like there's not a lot of combinations of players that are going to be able to stop them.
That's exactly how I feel about most elves teams, but especially the wood elves. If it's 11 on, as long as you're not more down than 2 players, I feel like the elves have the advantage off the pitch. It just
a skink catches one. Yeah. Homer got the welcome to the MML right there. He didn't think with a Soraya have in his back that he'd catch one, but the elf's definitely going to take advantage. And here comes the retaliation from Gruntosaurus, I believe that is.
Yeah, Gruntosaurus didn't appreciate that, making him look bad. And he really took care of that one.
He says, you can watch the rest of this game from the sidelines. We're not dealing with that kind of harassment of our new skinks.
Oh, so. And both teams do still have their apothecaries.
That's very handy. With two teams like this, to be able to hold the apothecary this long gives you a little bit more confidence to actually put players in harm's way. A lot of times you'll see as soon as an apothecary gets burned on one side, that coach will start to, you know, not take and put those high-value players out at risk as much. I know as soon as I burn mine, every block that my key players have, I wince a bit because that could be it. That, you know, you have no control over that dice roll.
I like to say that elves don't tend to be overly popular with a lot of coaches. I tell them, at least you don't have to clench your butthole every time you get hit. Because
that's true.
It is very nerve-wracking every time you take a block as an AV7 player.
It is a very helpless moment in a coach's life when that player they like, that they've spent, you know, game after game building up on that, and then all of a sudden it's like you just see the mighty blow coming down on him, and it's just like, so that the only time the animation shows is when there's an armor break, and that actually builds to that panic. It's like, oh no, an animation. Oh god, no, just be stunned.
I might try that.
Oh, it's you no longer look at every block the same as soon as the animation hits. You're done. Everything else goes away, and it's just like,
well, and that would take away at least a little bit of the edge for every block. Failed dodge or going for it. Yeah, failed GFI.
He comes back and throws down the six and just says, yeah, nah.
Right.
Prince has got this. I was just playing with your emotion.
I love the idea of extra AV on your War Dancer, by the way. But, you see, Prince isn't having any of that. He's going to make the move. He's got moves for days.
Oh, yeah. No, he walked into this league and announced himself in a way that most players wouldn't even have the inkling to try, you know.
No, certainly.
He shows up with a sense of style and panache that, are we going to see a foul? I saw the skink eyeball on that elf for a second there, and I've seen some skinks do some pretty nefarious things in their day.
No, and typically if you're going to see a foul from the lizard, that's where you would see it from.
Oh, yeah. Well, and it's interesting. He's actually got dive and catch on that one. So he's got some abilities that I don't think a lot of people...
I really thought were interesting the way TMNL's built with their skills. This is the first time I've really caught one of their games in its entirety.
Yeah, and it's one of those things where they've kind of got a Swiss Army knife kind of effect. Like,
they've got a passing game.
They've got a bit of a passing game. The one thing that really confuses me a bit is the Velociraptor. He actually has a passing skill and a catching skill, and I don't know if that's one of those where, depending on what situation they're in, they may use them differently, or if they just kind of went, both skills and we had the option to get them.
If I'm not mistaken, both of those are doubles. And you see, that skink getting pushed to the sideline, but he's not going to follow that up with his War Dancer.
Catch, I believe, is a regular roll. Accurate is definitely a double.
Okay. Maybe he's so just going for that Swiss Army knife feel for the skinks. I mean, they don't have a great life expectancy.
Yeah, it could be just experimental. But that was one of those. We're looking at some of the players on that. I like Kick on the Saurus.
We had a little discussion about that earlier, and I think any team benefits from Kick most of the time.
Yeah, well, and I think with a lot of the faster teams, it becomes more crucial. If you're playing with orcs, it's nice to be able to kick it deep, but you're generally going to have your formation spread out enough on the kickoff that you're not going to get caught. Like, oh, it's on the left or on the right is going to be an issue. I think with the faster teams, they can use the kick as an advantage because a lot of formations, the offense will have it planned in their head, like, okay, I'm going to get the ball, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And if they get that blitz, it absolutely, it's like basically turning the whole game on its head.
Yeah, absolutely. And as a Wood Elf coach, honestly, against most teams, there are some teams that I feel differently about, but against most teams, I'd rather be on defense. I have such a better, such a high chance with the right dice rolls of taking the ball away that I hate being on offense because I have to put my players more into harm's way to get down the field.
And that's very true. And I have moments where I look at it that way. My biggest thing is on offense, it's very difficult to protect your players because you have to protect the ball also.
Right. And once you start to lose some players.
Well, it doesn't even matter if you've lost players. If you have to commit three people to the ball, that's basically three blocks that are double teams if anybody's in contact.
Right.
So, I mean, you're looking at least three solid blocks where they're going to be two dice for the most part on every turn. And even with 8 AV, you're gonna lose the war of attrition at that point. And that's where a lot of times I prefer to start on defense because I can get those additional blocks in early and just kind of erode the other team so that the second half goes a little bit smoother for me. I'm walking in 1-2 players up, and I can really kind of, you know, protect the ball a little bit more loosely because all I have to do is mark all the other team.
Yeah, I typically, it's very rare that you'll see me take the ball first.
Where do I register for season 4?
That's the easiest way to avoid the 2-1 grind, is to kick the ball.
Yeah, definitely.
That's my biggest enemy, is the 2-1 grind.
And that's one of those, as an elf team, you have to watch out for that all the time. You know, I don't play elves often, but every time I play it, it always feels like, yeah, I can score when I want to, but
yeah,
then
I have to. Oh, he's got tackles.
Yeah, no, that was a well-selected list there. I wouldn't be surprised if they're going to ratchet up that pressure again. They got that strength 5 source in a good spot. They can move after a few players here, I think. That sideline's definitely helping them out some.
TMNL's got some strong positioning right now.
Well, and there's not a lot of elves on the other half of the field that they have to cover too. Yeah, that's a well placed Saurus there, because that's covering two tackle zones on two elves, and that movement elf is really in a bad spot now because he can't pinch in.
Registration for the season is on a rolling basis.
Should be
opening for new coaches next week.
That's one of those things where they're slowly just creeping in on them all.
It's going to be interesting though, because Thundin still has a 2+.
The farm is our open ladder
and
development competition.
Oh yeah, the elf mobility is still there, and especially with the catcher, he's got the dodge, he's got the extra movement with those with the sure feet and that. So it's not to the point where, like, this game's over, like, you know, he's got him in a chokehold and we're just waiting for him to tap out. You know, there are a lot of movements left. You could be looking at something with the war dancer breaking loose from the prehensile tail. I mean, it's not a great situation, but I mean, definitely
the tail really makes it hard.
This could be a sign. Yeah, but it's an automatic reroll, so as long as he can get loose.
Anything
can happen.
So how do you work your way to play in the main season?
He can still pop out, but it's one of those things where definitely limits his choices.
Honestly, what I would possibly think about doing, I mean, there's a lot of ways he could try to take this, is get the ball to the war dancer with the croc still on him and then leap out and go straight ahead.
Yeah, it's definitely not. It's not an easy approach. He can probably get all the way out there, or at least close enough to get a clean throw. But that's definitely not an easy throw or an easy catch.
No, he'd probably have to try to. Wow, yeah, he'd probably have to try to hand it off to the guard.
If you're going relay race, then yeah. But I mean, you're talking about. You're talking about in the rain making that kind of a relay. It's almost to the point where,
yeah, it is minus one.
I hate to say it, but the better move almost might be to try and crowd push him out of the situation he's in by placing an elf on that other corner and making a box. And I mean, it's not a great, but
if he could get that guard lineman over to block the source and the skink on the right, he could try to blitz that skink and run straight up the sideline as well. But he's got to make that dodge. Maybe a go for
the sideline's clear, but that you're still looking at with the two assists. That's not a great situation
He'd have to get that that lineman all the way down towards the goal line. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Mostly seniority.
With a dodge
if the
and a go
pro league
for
fills
it,
up, you can register
right
for the challenge league. Replacement teams get called up from the challenge.
Up, none of it.
Are
none
you
of it
on
is
the
overly
PSN
appealing.
Chat?
Still get chased down by skanks.
Yeah. Okay. We've got a move, and he's clear out of there. He's on the move.
See where he goes here.
Yeah. He's got 20 seconds. He's free of the immediate danger, but he's got a ticking time bomb in his hand because no matter where he goes or what he does, it's just bad news around every corner.
Time is just ticking down right now for the White Owls.
Yeah, he's doing quick math on the run.
He's gonna try to
and
that answer,
that burned,
I think.
Did that burn the dodge? Here comes the pass.
And
it's completed.
It.
My God, he's got 2 seconds.
Fast.
He's got to get out. He's running out of time. Oh, and there he goes.
He's free.
He's zigzagging. He's wobbling.
Now he's got to go. Oh my!
No,
that is
no that
the Crocs
that
the skink can get to him.
Well, the Crocs, you can't trust the Crocs. It's to the
Very
point where
true,
you can't take the blitz on the Crocs.
I think that's the only he's got a skink in the Crocs. I think are the only players he could realistically. Now he could try to blitz and free somebody up, but then he can't blitz the War Dancer.
Well, it's to the point where you could pin the War Dancer in if you can get the Crocs to actually move, and then if you get the skink on the other side.
Remind him
but
he
he's
has
gonna
a
throw
wizard.
Blocks in some other area, for some reason. I he doesn't seem to be too concerned with it. I would think that
maybe he
that
feels
he,
there's
he
a higher
be,
chance, but I think I would not risk having to spend a reroll here.
Well, the biggest issue that he really has is that even if he plays this perfect, if he gets two tackle zones on it, he's still looking at catching a wizard to the skull on one of his players, and the War Dancer can just dance in. He doesn't have to, you know. He doesn't
now,
have
we do
to
see
take
his
any risk.
Catcher finally go off the field. But, I mean, hearing the final stretch of the game, Seth says to remind Stu that he has the wizard. And he made the blitz, but he's not going to be able to not to get him down.
It's a reroll. That's a reroll situation,
loner.
And the loner fails. The real issue is that it actually pushes the War Dancer closer.
No,
he can still get another skink.
We're going to see a War Dancer leap, probably. I would imagine we'll see the skink try to come over and put another tackle zone, and we're going to see that War Dancer try to leap free for the touchdown.
That's kind of the point.
Well, and the other thing is where do you position that skink at?
Well, and actually now he's diagonal the rocks, so he's not going to be able to get a full tackle zones on him.
No, but it's still to the point where that's a plus movement War Dancer too.
That's making situations
from bad to worse.
No issue getting to the end zone. He can dodge around a little if he needs to.
Yeah,
Stu can try to hit the Crocs with the wizard as it stands right now and just laugh his way into the end zone.
Yeah. Tyrannosaurus flexes. He did his job to get there, but he's definitely not going to be happy about what may be coming to him next.
Well, and you see the War Dancer, now it'll be a minus one for the tail, but he's got a 3+ dodge straight to the end zone right now. So there's no need to even try to leap.
Yeah, no, it was a heck of a play to get him into that spot. But now
he had to catch it with the Crocs on him, he had to make the dodge away from the Crocs, so I mean...
It's kiddie play for him right now. This is like playing against nymph tackling dummies for that uh, for the war dancer.
I,
like
I think we just
like
saw this Saurus try to dodge. Yeah.
It's yeah. It was the AG.
The AG two.
It was the AG two. So it's up. There's the wizard, and the stun. So at least he comes back healthy at some point. But this is looking like a walk in. Oh, he's gonna blitz
gonna
too.
Blitz. Yeah, that's a walk in.
Well, he had the reroll, so that makes it even easier.
Yep. Yeah.
So
that's
he's gonna take his second touchdown and enjoy that. But that's one of those where the walk in touchdown was very easy after all the difficult things that they had to do to get to that point. You're talking about dodging out of tackle zones, dodging through a bunch of tackle zones. You know, a couple of gophers to get in range for the throw, throwing into a crotch, and then dodging out of it with the tail.
I feel like the only high percent he, I mean, it was a 2+ dodge. Now, the throw was probably, I think, a 3+, but the catch was the one he needed, because with the rain and with the crocs on him, that was a 50-50 catch attempt. Not a
significant and then dodging out wasn't easy either. I mean, he had dodge, but that's still a 67%.
I've seen that fail because of that tail plenty of times.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's that biggest panic moment ever, is when you're used to just getting away with all the, I think it's 83% dodges, and all of a sudden you click to dodge, and it's like, hey, what happened there? like no, the game's broken. Somebody call somebody. The game is wrong.
Oh, yeah, you can't. That's one of the struggles as an elf coach as well, is you are reliant on those dodges, and you have to plan that they're going to work. You can't say, oh, well, I need to hold off on this 2+ dodge roll.
That's one of those things where when playing an elf coach, making them take those dodge rolls is one of the biggest challenges, is just to keep them making dodge rolls, or keep them, you know, wasting two guys to get the blocks or something. You got to keep them on the point where they got to burn the reroll, so that whenever that little slip up happens, that it punishes them that bad. Because otherwise, if you just let them kind of have space to roam, they're just going to run around and make you look stupid the whole day. It's like trying to catch a butterfly without a net, just your hands. It's just you look like a fool. Because they just have that mobility and that agility to just twist you around in circles for, you know, 6 turns, and then next thing you know, it's like they're giving you the middle finger as they score while you're on the other side of the field looking stupid.
Still wondering where they were.
Mm-hmm.
Seth says, yay for LPS.
Some cheerleaders get paid more than the players.
Yeah, and it looks like he's definitely lining up to try a one turn to get the tie. I'm not sure where the blitz is going to come from. I think he's going to load in next to the Crocs, and then probably push out Homer, it looks like. Or he may be looking to push out Ornithop, you know. Ornithop Ona?
I went through this issue earlier. It is Ornithopona.
Ah, that sounds French.
He says it's based on a dinosaur.
I believe that. I definitely believe that.
I don't doubt him. I just know it's a pain in the ass to say sometimes when you're just trying to continue your casual speech flow.
Yeah, generally it's easier to say things like Prince or Gruntosaurus than it is to say something that's very foreign to you.
Well, and the White Owls, War Dancers aren't exactly very commentary-friendly either.
Oh, yeah.
They've each an apostrophe in the middle.
Yeah, and generally at that point, I give up after a while and just start calling them randomly generated name. I'm just like, you know what, you didn't put effort in, so why should I have to?
I just say, and the War Dancer would catch, or, you know.
Yeah. We're going to name you by your ability, not your name. Forget you.
Let's see here. I've been trying to experiment a bit with the one turns. There's actually Preach has a very nice resource on the site for one turn touchdowns. And
I've seen that Fumble has a nice thing for the one turning. I've seen a couple of different resources that that help with it, but it's one of those things where a lot of times, like, you can read the stuff, but it really comes down to trying it and working
that's
on it.
Definitely.
Because in the end, like, you can read the guide and it'll tell you how to do it, but it's going to tell you, okay, the people have to be lined up in a certain way, and that's you have to push like this and this and this. Learning the mechanics of it and how close you need to get the player is a lot more useful. So, like, right now, he needs to push Homer, I believe it was. Yeah, he needs to get Homer two more squares. So he needs to complete the push and push him forward and then circle around one or two, I believe it's two, two players to pin the next push.
Now that's
The skink has to push, and then he needs to get his two sauruses all the way around. So he's got to get a saurus on either side of that skink for the next push. And that's where you actually need another player on the side, or the blitz had to come. He needs to not follow the blitzer up and then move that saurus over where he had to move Prince. And that frees up Prince to take that extra spot. Well,
there it is.
He can... Okay, but here, so then he can load up the other one. He's still got an opportunity. Mm-hmm. And then the other danger is that Homer doesn't have the ball yet, too. So he still has to do that relay. So he's going to take the knockdown. He's got him in range.
There it is.
And then
impressive chain pushing, regardless of whether it works out.
It was well done. Let's see if he's picked his location yet, though. It looks like he's favoring that sideline that he may be trying to get in through past that movement lineman. Because that looks like probably his best shot. There must have been a failed pickup because the screen cut out for me.
Son of a bitch! Yeah, it was a failed pickup.
That is the sound of a man that failed a pickup.
I'm watching it on Twitch right now. He failed it. Yeah. And went out of bounds and
it jumped out, and then it popped over towards where the guy actually came from. So, if he would have just stood there and had a fan throw it over, it would have been a lot easier.
Shoot. All right. You guys take charge of those post-game interviews. Yeah.
Shots, please lead the way, buddy.
Oh, okay. Well, who wants to go first? Should we let Sirius cool off a little bit after that failed pickup? You know, let him have a cold drink of water and that, and we'll get the White Owls coach in here.
Yeah, let's go ahead and talk to the winning coach here first.
Yeah, he needs to get through this quick so we can go celebrate in the locker room. All right, so is he live?
I'm there.
Oh, you're here? Okay, so you got a win. It's a little bit bittersweet. You end the year with a win, but I've heard a lot of good things from the White Owls. This is the first game I got to see. Pretty impressive. Did you have a game plan specifically against the Lizards, or was it more of a fluid kind of thing?
I'm not really good at game plans, so I act and react.
Okay, and apparently that worked pretty good. From the sounds, so what?
For this game, yeah.
Yeah, from what I heard, the opening half was pretty passive. Both teams were feeling each other out. Was that part of what you like to do? Keep your players healthy for the first half, so you have a little bit better chance of not getting outnumbered in the second. Or was it just kind of how it played out?
What is ogre on ogre action?
Elves in general, I think. Wood elves specifically. I like to defense first. That way, I have my full rooster to defend, and then I just try to build the wall to give them one blitz per turn, maybe a second hit if it doesn't go my way. Try to minimize the injuries or the knockouts or all that.
You seem to have been pretty effective at that. What were you thinking on the turn where you had to dodge out, run across half the field, and make a throw in the rain into basically a Crox's mouth? Like, we were sitting here in the commentary panicking, trying to figure out what in the heck we would do in that situation. It just seems like a hopeless moment. And then out of that, in the last seconds, like, you just pulled out a rainbow out of the clouds.
In true elf fashion.
Yeah. I mean, it's a nightmare for anybody when all of a sudden you just see your defense getting just unraveled at that point. Like, at what point did you just go, this is what I'm doing, and just took off and did it? Like,
yeah, because there was only, what, 15 seconds?
Yeah.
Well, I tried to look at all the other options that I had. I was hoping to knock that skink up top. It didn't work because I wanted to run through that way first.
Yeah.
It didn't work out. Know? So then I had to rely on plan B that I did not have. Stadia since the last decade.
That's back to that act and react.
Exactly. So then I was looking at everything, and 15 seconds on, I'm like, well, there's not a lot of options available. I have to give it a try. Because if I don't, I'm getting knocked over, and there's four skinks running after the ball.
I feel like as an elf coach, there comes a lot of points in the game where you're calculating risks, and at some point you basically just say, all right, fuck it. Like, this is what we're doing. Like,
yeah. Okay, we're not going to think anymore. We're just going to make this happen.
Exactly.
Let's see what happens next.
Like, I planned my dodges correctly to get my runner out of there, and then I didn't even think about the catch, the tackle on my catcher, and I didn't even think about the raining. I was like, it's my only chance. I have to get it back.
Yeah, it was a huge calculated risk, and it paid off. It's one of those things where you see only a handful of teams that can really pull that off. I guarantee you, you'll never see any Beastman kind of pull off that maneuver. I mean, orcs have nightmares of it.
Last week when I played,
that's why we're seeing less orcs.
Yeah.
Last week when I played against Don, I was at a play like this. I had no other options. I wanted to do it, and I rolled a double one on my dodge. And then
yeah.
He got the ball and he scored.
Yeah, I heard of quite a bit of praise for the White Owls from Don. You may have had a bad break there, one or two points, but he definitely he wasn't shy about giving you your due respect also, though. So that's a pretty high amount of praise from a coach that's well respected in the league.
And that has good chances on maybe winning that trophy.
Yeah, definitely. That's a scary team moving into the playoffs. That is that's for certain. And then also breaking news today was that they're coming back next season too. So that nightmare isn't over for the East yet.
That's perfect. I think as a Wood Elf, I'm well armed against Lizard teams, as their skinks are only two strength, and when I'm stuck against the wall, I can leap in and strip ball the ball. So.
Yeah,
chances.
Definitely. You've got some pretty well set up war dancers, so that'll definitely treat you well in the future. Have you re-signed in for the next season already? Are the White Owls going to be returning?
I'm coming back. I'm going in the Wicked Forest if it gets approved, and I'm looking into kicking Jest's in the face.
You're hoping for some repeat performances similar to this one. Well, I definitely congratulate you on the win. I'm sure that you have a lot of celebrating to do. It's a great way to go out of the season. I believe that you guys missed playoffs and a bowl game, but you'll definitely be retooling for next season, and we look forward to seeing the White Owls out there again.
Exactly. That's good. So thank you all, and thank you, Jess.
Yeah, and speaking of Jess, we'll bring him in. Hopefully he's got most of his screaming at the fans and players and random people walking about the field out of the way, and we can get a couple of mellower, calm words out of him before he goes back on his tirade.
What happened? I blacked out.
Trust me, you can watch down the replay, but it was skink pornography for the most part. So, I mean, there's going
to
be a lot of blurred areas. It was a rough moment. Not the shining moment that the TMNL was looking for to go out of this this regular season with. But
the bad kind of pornography.
Yeah, I don't know. it was that type of porn where you delete it out of your browser history.
Yikes.
It was that porn.
Like, what did I just watch?
Yeah, I started off just looking at the stuff I like, and all of a sudden I clicked a couple of banners, and I got into that area of the internet. And
feel a little ashamed after yourself.
Yeah, it's just like, did I just rape myself? Yeah, it was one of those things, but I definitely got to give you credit. You basically engaged a one-turn touchdown that I haven't seen, like, a pro team do. That was one of those scenarios where, like, all your blocks and everything set up perfectly. You were, you know, let's say 4, maybe 5 dice rolls away from pulling a non, you know, scave and one-turn touchdown.
Dude, can I be honest here? I've never done that before.
Were you looking at it on a website as you were doing it? Like,
I think I saw somebody try to do it on me. I think it was Moreshots trying to do it on me in the farm. I was like, that looks interesting. I'll figure this out as I go along.
Yeah, I think I remember that game. I can't remember if I was trying with Skaven or a different team, but yeah, I've dabbled in one turning a few times, and it feels really awkward because it's the only time in the entire game where you're like, I need a push. I just need a push. Yeah. Nothing else. Just need a push. I don't want to push. I don't want to pow. Both downs like a nightmare. It's like, where was this the whole game?
Oh, my guys were good at doing that, though. They definitely pushed the whole game. They kept doing it into that final one. I thought it was aligning for me, to be honest, because, you know, like, the weather cleared up. The pushes all came up, like, perfect. Like, the last one was the pow, so he was... I mean, that guy has diving catch, so he's wide open. I had my Agi 4 skink with a throw, so that would have been a doable throw. And then, of course, he decides to fumble the ball, so that was great. Really
that was the stab in the heart. That was one of those things where that was that primal scream that came out of you. It was just that moment where it's like, this is where you lose like 3 months at the end of your life. That was that scream. It's just like, you know what? You're coughing in the hospital. You're like, yo, doctor, how long do I have? And he goes, remember that scream? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it actually showed up on the X-ray.
Pickup.
You're like, and what's crazy is like, I was just like, oh, this is when the bullshit happens. But for me, I'm getting elf bullshit happening. Yes, yes. It's gonna happen. I'm gonna stick it to the elves. I'm gonna write articles for days about this. I'm gonna be writing articles to the start of season 4. Oh my god. Yeah, and again, I figured out how to do something I've never done before on the fly. I was proud of that, and then it just didn't work out. But at least, you know, I had some good takeaways.
That was excellently executed. That I mean, that was beautiful.
Thanks. I probably couldn't do it again if you asked me to.
Well, you just keep that in your back pocket because I'm sure this situation will arise again where you're going to need to...
I actually have that one-turn page bookmarked now.
On Fumble? I've looked at it. Yeah, I've looked at it. I've never, like, sat there and tried to do... Like, it's just... I don't know. But, you know, actually, who did it to me? NTB actually performed one on me in... because he had the war dancer with the grab, and I don't want to give Stu ideas, but it was frustrating. So.
Oh, so you're saying I need to put grab on my war dancer? That's what you're talking about.
I'm not telling you anything.
Grab is a useless ability. You don't really need it.
No, yeah, you don't want that. That's bad.
Because my greased up deaf guy is only one move short of a one turner. And he's got short feet as well, so all I need to do is push him one square.
Yeah.
I tried to do it in my last challenge match to tie, and I failed. I rolled double pals.
I'm going to let you know right now, the most dangerous thing to do to a player is turn him into a one-turner. You will instantly, and I mean instantly, you will instantly get a bounty on that player, and people will be looking for his head.
Dude, I was looking for... There were times when I knew where the ball was straight across the field, and I was really thinking about using my blitz just to hit his war dancer. Just constantly. I was just like, those war dancers need to come off the field.
He didn't get the strip ball one off for a while.
What's that?
You had the strip ball one off the pitch for a while with the KO.
That was a major breath of fresh air there, but... he did a really, you know, I did, in hindsight, it's exactly, I think, what was Sasser said that, or he said, you know, why didn't you match him up one-on-one, and, you know, I have also seen it happen before where you try to, you know, put the pressure on the elves and force them to use the rerolls, and then next thing you know, you put one-on-one on every guy, and next thing you know, a few dodges later, you know, it's 3-on-1 of them on you, and it's, you know, I did not want to start the game down a couple of players because the elves came out of nowhere and blindsided me.
I think that's pretty much just a... There's no real right answer in that kind of situation. I mean, I see Sasser's point, but I agree with you too. Because as soon as you start trying to match up with those wood elves, I mean, they can change from being conservative to aggressive in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. And those war dancers would be all over those skinks. I mean...
In retrospect, obviously, like, because it worked out for me much better the second half when I forced him to be on my pace. And the first half, like, I was on his, I was waiting for that opening, and man, I was one turn away and he jumped on it. And he's a very competent coach, and, you know, you never, it just depends how that situation plays out. Sometimes he's really aggressive, and today he was surprisingly conservative, and he's normally really aggressive. So I was actually kind of waiting for him to come in.
He would not be baited either in the first half.
No.
I mean, it was, yeah, he was very patient.
I've got my lack of tackle really hurts me, and that was when I took most of the level ups. TMNL, I brought him up on the farm mostly, but when I had the chance to get tackles, I thought about it and said, I don't really need it. I don't have any elves. And then, you know, after Mgato dropped out, white elves came in, and next thing you know, I have an elf problem. So, you know, I'm going to have to build my team differently.
You didn't beat the White Owls this year then. You tied and you lost, right?
It's always like, it's I'm one play away. You know, there was two times I was one play away here.
That's how it always feels.
You know, in the last game, there was like literally all I had to do was dodge out with my skink with dodge with no tackle. Like nobody had tackle that was in his tackle zone. I said to dodge out, and I was clear, gone for the touchdown. 67% twice roll, and he trips me up, sends me to the dirt, and we tied. So. It was just that took the wind out of my sails. I know what Thundin felt like when, like, I cornered him in that side. I pinned to the sideline. I was like, he's mine. The only thing I got to worry about is if he hits me with the wizard, and I know he can't do it while he still has the ball. So the only thing I was already looking forward to, there's going to be a scramble for the ball. He's probably going to use the wizard on me and go for that. And by the way, that's the other thing that kept me from getting real aggressive in the first half. Knowing he had the wizard, didn't allow me to cage up the way I normally wanted to. Like, when I've played him before, I run up on him, I just go gangbusters with like several swords, and there's no way he can even gang up because I got a couple of strength 5 guys on the field with guard, so it's usually a problem with him. But knowing that wizard was on, like, you know, in retrespect, I would have just forced him to use it in the first half, got
right,
it out of the way, and
20/20.
Came back.
I mean, I understand the point of how you approached it.
Yeah,
and that comes back to the just kind of an ongoing, you know, conversation that people have been having is what's the bigger effect of the wizard, the threat of the wizard, or the actual action of the wizard? And that's, you know,
it depends on the coach you're playing too. Some coaches do not care. They're gonna stick with what they're gonna do and just basically hope that you have a dud.
Yeah. But no, he played it. He played it well, man. I kept waiting for that one stupid opening, and I swore it was coming when there were 15 seconds left. And I don't know how he managed to move three guys in 15 seconds.
He did a hell of a job at that.
Clear across the field. I would have still been fumbling where do I click? Do I click here? He managed to.
Well, when he took the ball from you in the first half, you said it yourself when you came into the broadcast that one more turn and you would have scored.
Yep.
I mean, it was almost guaranteed. But he had it. I mean, he waited. He wouldn't be baited in, and he played it smooth. And it looks like we've got a pretty good matchup going into next season. Then with White Owls taking on the reigning conference champion.
This is gonna be a rivalry, definitely. Well, I'm glad I clarified with Preach ahead of time that I'm still the conference champion, even though I lost the game.
That would have been a hell of an upset.
That kind of brings us into an interesting position. What is the confidence of your team at this point, coming in off of two losses going into the playoffs?
Well, look, I told Thundin this. I had nothing at stake in that game, and I definitely played to win, but I played a lot more aggressively than I would have normally played. So we weren't broke up about that loss. Like, I went for a touchdown in, like, turn, you know, the third turn of the second half, you know, whereas I would have normally sat Spermadactyl back there for a lot longer and let it develop and milked it so that I had either a tie or a win, right? Yeah, again, I played him hard. It's not like I let up or I wanted him to win, but I also didn't feel right about doing the, let me just sit in the backfield with my movement 8 skink, you know, and let you just, you know, your playoff hopes go down the drain without me really playing. So I gave him that. But, yeah, you know, and I ended up paying for it with a couple of my guys. Not having Kilmono Dragon really, really hurt. Because he's my one guy with Mighty Blow.
Yeah. So you're definitely rolling into the playoffs. Is there any team that you would hate to see first round of the playoffs, and any team you'd love to see first round of the playoffs from the teams that are in?
Good question.
like, what's your nightmare scenario right now? Like, what's the worst thing that could happen to you week one?
You know, honestly, everybody that's left in there is a problem in their own way. You know, they all match up. You know, if I went lizard on lizard. You know, I'm serious. They're all a problem because as I think it through, you know, if I get the lizard on lizard action going, Don has those three strength five guys, so that's not fun. And then
yeah, but in that situation, you're probably walking with a wizard too, so that wouldn't be the Magazine end of the day.
Editor. And the first time I played Don, I didn't take the wizard because I didn't have rerolls then. So that would help, but that's not, obviously, it's not my ideal scenario. Don's a good coach either, too. But, you know, at the same time, it's not like I got it easy if I faced the Scuttlebutts, right? Or who else? The Treehawks? Did the Treehawks make it? Or are they still in it? Or
well, that's still up. It'll be either Scuttlebutts or Treehawks.
That's Wrecking more and more Crew's of these dodgy guys.
Yeah, Wrecking Crew's in. Blitzkriegers are in. We have no idea what could happen in the Noble South still. That's a three-person race that could end any sort of ways. I can't remember what other teams are on the bubble.
I actually have it open here.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, let me go ahead.
Awesome.
Okay.
I mean,
so
it'll probably be like
through.
The one that I pick because they're just a little less impressive. But everybody's a threat. Everybody's definitely a threat. It's not like you get somebody and go, all right, I'm going to beat up on these guys. Cause
yeah.
You know, and I find it very amusing that there was recent talks talking about eliminating CPOM when all of the major contenders have dodgy guys. You know what I mean? Like, you're talking about rats, elves, even the skinks. You know, I benefit off of being dodgy. So if somebody, like when Thundin walked in with four guys with Mighty Blow, and that's really the reason, that's the only reason he won. He couldn't stick with me, but he destroyed my guys, leveled them.
Yeah.
You know, with half the blocks.
Okay, so I'm looking. We have the Gladiators and Reptile Dysfunction, and the Gladiators go, if they win...
Goblin,
or if they tie and Mouse loses, Dysfunction will go
any
if they win.
You may
just
have
flat out, if they win, they're in. And then Mouse will make it in if they win, and the Gladiators Dysfunction game ends in a tie.
Yeah, so that's a bit of a long shot, but I mean,
so I'll tell you right now, out of the people that we talked about, like Treehawks, Scuttlebutts, the Leaping Lizard, who was a Blitzkriegers? Right now, I would probably take the winner
crew
of the Noble South Conference as of now, as of the people you mentioned, just because the other people are, like, extraordinary. And this group of coaches are really, really, really good, but maybe don't have that, you know, maybe there's a smidgen of difference in the reputation, at least, and from what I've watched.
Yeah, one other playoff question for you. Will you play any differently now that basically if there's not a winner at the end of regulation, it goes into overtime, and it's a point where it's basically a coin flip could really decide the game at that point?
Would I play differently in regulation to avoid overtime?
Yeah, would you play more conservatively to try and get to overtime, or is this going to be one of those where you don't want it left to a coin flip where a tie could be, you know, the game could be decided by the coin flip of who gets the ball?
I don't know. I don't really know how, because, you know, it's not like I had to make that hard call here. So I don't know.
I think
know.
That's going to depend a lot on the teams that are in the game, too. Like myself, I as Wood Elves, I would probably want to avoid overtime.
Yeah. And that could be how it is. If you get matched up with like a Treehawks or a Mouse or a team like a Scuttlebutts, where they're a little bit more fragile team, where maybe your Sorai could, you know, weed out a couple of them. Maybe you play more for a longer game. But
right.
No, it's interesting that because for me, I we get so used to playing in a game where it's like, okay, 16 turns and it's done, where we hit the bowl games and the playoffs, and all of a sudden it really does throw a wrench into everything that we've done, because all of a sudden it's like, well, okay, if I don't score at turn 16, well, it's a 1-1 tie. All of a sudden the game keeps going on. You know, it does change a twist to what we're actually used to.
That's a good point. I think, like, depending on what the situation was, you'd be less prone to, say, take aggressive dodges. You know, right. like Jess was looking to do at the end with the one turn, going through three tackle zones. You may reconsider that depending on the flow of the game.
Yeah. If you're already at a tie, you know, it could change strategy and judgment.
Yeah, this is tough, man. I'm looking. I had 50 blocks, succeeded to his 20. I can't believe that.
I mean, Stu played a classic elf game. It was it was something to see. Well.
I don't know, you guys watched it. I don't think either of us made key mistakes, except maybe strategy-wise, I probably should have been more bashy in the first half. Because if you think about it, first half, right, we were was moving. I would get one or two blocks a turn because we were both, like, not really engaging. And I still managed to get 50 blocks in the game after I decided to engage in the second half.
What pastos?
From the second half, they finally started to go down a little bit. It was mostly KOs, but yeah, you finally started to get a couple off the pitch. Stu was content to play the standard. I'm gonna sit one zone away from you and not try to not eat blocks.
Right.
Yeah, and that's just both coaches actually playing well. It's one of those things where like I said, you know, a lot of times people will feel each other out a little bit in the first half. And kind of try and figure out how best to attack the other person, and then the halftime adjustments kind of happen, and both coaches, from the sounds of it, really ratcheted up the aggression at that point.
Yeah, especially when I was down 1-0, I was like, you know what, we're gonna fight. just gotta sit back
there
and run.
It had to suck to have the Crocs knock the War Dancer down after he So he snatched it, and didn't you knock him down, and the ball came loose, and then he ended up coming up and taking it again, right?
No. Remember, I scored, so I knocked it loose. He tried to grab it. He surrounded it with his guys. I knocked him into the ball. It came loose. Homer picked it up, so his first Homer scores, ties it up. He gets it back. I pin him in the corner, and then he makes that amazing across-the-field run to a freaking all covered with the Crocs hanging over him. It must have looked like, you know, when, like, rain. Surfers with the tidal wave, like, over them and they're in the pipe? That's what it looked like. He caught that and then dodged out. I didn't even know what to do at that point. I was just like, okay. I see how it's going down. And somehow I still managed to put a tackle zone on him. So that was my one key mistake, I think. That's where I may have screwed up. I don't think it would have mattered because he still blitzed his way out of it. On the skink, but
he could
that
have
was,
left too if it really yeah. came down to
yeah.
it. Also,
the
Elves had so many options that he could have dodged out, he could have blocked his way out.
Once he made the catch,
I was just trying to push him diagonally so that I could have enough so I could get the skink over there, and that was because I wanted to shorten the field. And it is what it is.
Yeah, but the War Dancer, there's really no. I mean, you need like four or five players to truly shut down a War Dancer's movement. You've got to make him do the leap roll, but...
They're so OP. They're so OP.
I don't feel that way at all.
I mean, obviously, I see their value in the game, but again, when you compare, you know, anytime anybody complains about that guy with, you know, C-Palm, or even just the claws and the Mighty Blow, or the my answer is War Dancer. That's it. Those
War
guys
Dancers are probably the unequaled starting piece.
Yeah.
I mean,
they come out of the
War
box
Dancers
ready to
are great
damage.
When they start. War Dancers are great when they
start.
They
are frail, though.
When they get ended, it's even greater.
Yeah, it really is.
Seeing one of those go down is just it brings a little bit of warmth to my cold heart.
I think everybody in the audience who's not a Wood Elf coach, when they see the War Dancer go down, they're like, yes, get him.
Yep. And I told Stu, us Wood Elf brethren have to stick together. We are very outnumbered when it comes to positive feelings about our teams.
Yeah. Yeah, well, good game, Stu, man. Thanks a lot. Thanks, guys, for calling. This was a real pleasure.
Yeah, that was a great guy.
Oh, definitely.
That
was a good guy.
I really appreciate it. Like Rez said, normally I'm the guy calling him. This is the first time anybody's announced one of my games, so I really appreciate that. This for your first time. That was really awesome. You did a really good job. Even you carried it by yourself at first, which is really tough to do. So,
thanks, really man. I appreciate that. I just tried not to rely too heavily on any kind of bad puns.
Why not?
They work with two people. The puns, you need two people.
Oh, is that how that works?
You two have a great... it cracks me up listening to you guys going on, man. It cracks me up.
Just wait until you get to the point where you start making up stories on the field, like, as you go along and playing off of each other. That's
The shit you guys were saying, actually, it was Shots and Stunt, but the shit that Shots was saying when it came to Sexy Rexy during that challenge game, it had me dying. Because I was listening. I wasn't talking, but I was listening. I was a dying, dude.
It's good stuff.
But,
I just try and keep it interesting. Every now and then, you gotta ad lib and just have a good time with it. That's what this game's all about.
Yep. All right, fellas. So I'll end the broadcast now. Right. Thanks a lot.
Yep.
We'll see you all next time or on the farm or somewhere.
Later on,
TML, we'll see you all in the playoffs. So.
Yep. Yeah, hopefully we got our bad luck out of the way now.
Yeah, you evaporated that stuff.
Back in 24, 79, all right. See ya.